Greetings. This is Joe Bonamassa, and I rarely do this. My conversation with the comedian Jeff Garland was a frank, wonderful exchange of ideas and how he explained the craft of comedy. But I also blew the intro, and he wouldn't let me do another intro. So I'm kind of doing this intro in spite, but also in honor of him. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, you know him from the Goldbergs, Curb Your Enthusiasm, and his wonderful stand-up comedy routines, Mr. Jeff Garland.
Do you know what I'm doing in the fall? I'm going on a tour in September, because at that point I will be vaccinated.
Right.
And I'm going on a tour. I need to build up again. You know, prior to COVID, the longest I ever went, and I'm not exaggerating, not doing stand-up in 38 years,
mm-hmm.
2 weeks.
Right.
And it will be over a year and a half the next time I do it. Because my style is not designed to do on Zoom or to do these drive-in shows. No, thank you. Not my thing. Yeah. But I'm going to all these comics. What's that?
Honk if you think it's funny.
Yeah, I know. Or even like on Zoom, it interrupts you. Like, you know, like it cuts off one person's microphone. Well, it's bad. Yeah. So I'm going to all these clubs because I need to get back in shape. But I'm doing a tour of, I think, 14 clubs around the country with not getting paid. I'm not getting paid. I want them. I'll pay for my own airfare, my own hotel. I want these clubs have been hit hard. Yep. And I can afford it to work for free, and I'll get back in shape. But they're all like thrilled. My agent told me some of them were crying. They were so grateful.
That's really awesome.
Well, you know, it's like you just rehearse with your band, okay? Mm-hmm. Being a comedian, I got my dog here with me in my house. Tell me if you think. Well, actually, they did a bit like that on SNL with John Belushi years ago, where he was a stand-up comic in the forest playing to animals, and it was very funny. But no, I have no way of rehearsing except by being a person.
Yeah, I mean, and you got a woodshed. This is all great. I'm going to count down from five and give you the introduction, and we'll just, this is it. This is the non-interview.
Well, by the way, just so you know how long I've been doing this, I thought we already started.
Right. I just got to give you an intro, you know.
Well, no, but give me an intro. Here, can I recommend something?
Yes.
I love what we just talked about. You don't have to include it, but give an intro in the middle of the show. Give an intro right now and you know, let people at first go, well, who's that? What's he? Oh!
Yeah, you know, this is a first. If you're wondering who my guest is today.
That's it.
Live from Nerdville.
Yes.
My guest is not only my friend, one of the funniest people alive. You know him from his work on Arrested Development, The Goldbergs, and, of course, Curb Your Enthusiasm. Ladies and gentlemen. Let me do that again. Nice screen.
No, but you're not a perfectionist. What are you talking about? No one's expecting you. No one would judge you on a one-word correction. See, real is the beauty of life. And real is when you play a note out of tune. It's like, what the fuck? And you fix it. And we're all there. We see it. It's great. The only time you maybe want to go for having the perfect thing is if you're making an album,
right.
You know, that's not live. But I love, you're a human being, Joe. You're not Mr. Speaker. When did you become a host? Stop it. You're fine.
All right.
I'm not letting you do another intro.
Right,
I will interrupt them all.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you. And by the way, the only reason why I want to do it again is my bullshit Italian pride and the two chips that I have on my shoulders. That's the only reason. Otherwise, it was fine.
And by the way, pride, one of the thing that ego, pride, that shit gets you in trouble.
It does. It's got
me. I know.
Yeah. So,
and by the way, I'm a Jew and I'm proud of you, my Italian friend. I'm proud of you. Do you know my brother told me the other day when I said I was going to do this with you? He said, and this is verbatim, you know, he's my number one.
Oh,
you're number one. He goes, by far, my favorite of all the favorites.
Well, thank you. Tell your brother I'm very.
And Michael. He'll watch this.
Thank you, Michael. I'm yeah. on.
And you'll meet him someday. I'll bring him to a show or, you know, whatever.
Well, that's, you know, it's exciting that you're getting back on the road. We're going to go do some shows at the end of March.
Really? Where and how?
We're doing red states. We're doing Florida, Texas, Alabama, and Georgia. And they're truncated audiences, but they are audiences. And one of the things that we did in the fall was we did this pay-per-view live stream event, and we're doing another one in Austin. And it was, we had 2,100 cardboard cutouts of human beings in the room. And they were, for a minute, you would squint your eyes a little bit and you're ripping into a solo and you actually felt like there was a crowd until the end of the song. And it's silence. And all you heard was,
okay, hold on.
The footsteps of the techs bringing the other instruments.
By the way, can I say this? That gives you a little idea, not huge, because people at home watching, of course, were like, wow, that was great. But you get a little idea what it's like to bomb. That's silent.
Let me ask you that question. What do you do when you bomb? Because that, to me, that's the true pro. It's like when everything goes as planned and you're getting the laughs and you're getting, you know, it's like, yeah, this is the way it was supposed. That's the way I wrote it or whatever. And then it tanks. Because to me, comedy, stand-up comedy is the sports equivalent would be boxing. It's the longest 3 minutes of your life. It's the longest 15 minutes, longest hour. Yeah. What do you do?
I, at this point in my career, embrace it. When I say embrace it, I try communicating with an audience the best I can. And I can, that's where the art goes out the window and craft takes over. Mm-hmm. You have to go to the things you've learned. I've been doing this 38 years, almost as old as you are, okay? 38 fucking years. So I have bombed at least, when I say bomb, I mean like bomb, at least 500 times, at least, if not more. And you have to go to craft. And by the way, for me at this point in my career, the craft works. So I'd say that I bomb maybe once a year. Okay. I have shows that I don't enjoy because I have to go into the craft and work harder than I have to. And I come up in a pool of sweat and the audience has no idea they're sucky. I don't tell them they're sucky. Although if there is a level of silence, you have to talk about the elephant in the room. But that's always a good way to get them back. Because if you're vulnerable, yet confident and in control, they embrace that. So calling it out also can be very, very helpful.
Well, you know, the thing is, too, is like, it's like I know as soon as the lights go out, like during the intro tape, I know exactly what I'm inheriting. Now, it could be Monday is electric and Friday's dead. And you're like, well, it's Friday night, you know, and then you just go, I got to work harder tonight. But
it's the gig, man. Whether we're artists or not, we're professional entertainers. We are professionals, true professionals. That means when Monday they're going ape shit, it's like, how lucky am I? Friday, I'm also lucky to have a show, but fuck, this is not going to be as fun. Because for me, my style, I improvise a lot. If the audience is good, it only winds me up in a bigger way and the show is better. But on the nights when I resort to craft, they don't know it's not as good a show as the night before. They have no idea. And hopefully they like it, but it's, you know, the fun makes me excited.
Right. Now, what's the difference between bombing when you're an unknown comedian and when you're a major celebrity?
There's one big difference, trust.
Right.
When I'm me now, they, even if I'm not doing well initially or they're not vibing with me initially, they trust that I know what I'm doing. They paid to see me. When I was a young comic, who the fuck is this guy? Get him off and please bring on the next guy. I've not earned anything with them over a period of work and time. So when you bomb at the beginning, they want nothing to do with you. And the most impressive recoveries, and they're few and far between, are when a young comic recovers from bombing, because that is fucking rare. When you're, you know, 3 years into it and you're eating it, you basically have to go in your head, I'm eating it. That's all that's going to happen tonight. It's not turning around, you know, because it's not. They don't trust you.
Well, you know, that's the thing. It's like, you know, I crack a few dry jokes and I can get the room to laugh. And I do probably 3 or 4 minutes of material on the city that I'm in, you know, and I have the ultimate escape hatch, because when I bomb, I go, and a 3 and a 4, Anton, let's go. Let's keep the show going, you know, and you're done, you know. And, but, you know, like, you know, a few of my friends are like, you'd have a second career this time. I go, there's no way I would get up on an open mic night and do any kind of material, because to me, it would be very, the minute it didn't go as planned, I have nothing. There's no net, and you're just going to.
By the way, I always tell young comics, you better be in this for the long haul, because if you're not, sometimes people are like, well, if I don't get famous, and then I know what they're about, you know, it was, if I don't get famous by a certain time, I'm out, or this is too hard. I think it was Parcells, the football coach,
Bill, who
was talking about a football player, and he said he loves football. He loves football. He plays football because he loves football, not because of what football brings him.
Right.
And there are people in music, people in comedy, people in sports who are doing it because they love it.
Right.
Love it. And then there are comedians I know and I see, and I go, they're just in it for the fame, the social media. Someone's filling them. And I'm not saying that people who are doing it because they love it aren't insecure and don't have problems, but I'm saying it's so clear when someone is not doing it because they love it. And I love, for me, look, I'm a big fan of music. I love music. By the way, my album that you worked on with Joanna is coming to me this week.
Oh, great. Thank you very much.
Sure. I gigged with her at Chicago Music Exchange. We did a show. It was actually for Gibson at Chicago Music Exchange. She is a badass. Holy crap, Joanna Connor. Wow. And then I know you worked on this album with her, and I'm getting it.
You know, thank you very much. And she earned it. You know, she's one of those kind of artists that out of sight, out of mind. You know, she was sitting there doing those gigs in, you know, Kingston Mines in Chicago doing.
Yeah, that was her spot.
Yeah, it 5 nights a week, 4-hour shifts. And, you know, we all knew her, you know, from the 90s. And she just was underserved by the business, you know, because it's music and business. And I saw a video of her at some festival that somebody took and they posted, and, you know, and here she is like this bull in a china shop, like with bad intentions. And I go, if we could bottle that and put it in a span of an album,
right?
And just find that devil, find that demon, and you know, exacerbate, you know, what's already there and build on it. And I was just so proud of her because I told her, I said, we have to suspend our friendship while I do this for you, because I'm going to push you and you're going to hate me.
Push. You got to. That's awesome. I cannot wait to hear it, because I love her. When she gets going with the slide, I'm like, stand back. Wow. Yeah, she's a badass.
What is it about Chicago that produces that kind of artistry, both on a comedic side and a music side? Because there's, you know, you're from Chicago, you know the second city.
Bob Newhart, you could go back to, you know, and blues. Do I need to explain Chicago and the blues to your people watching this? I do not. Yeah. But it's the same thing,
you know. It's like one of the best food towns in the world. There's something about it.
It's so, I just know in Chicago, there's no bullshit. Do you know what they call Chicago, the Windy City?
No.
not because of winter.
Right.
And by the way, I've been knocked over by the wind in the winter. It's the Windy City because of politics.
Mm-hmm.
They blow their crap.
Right.
So politics in Chicago can be a dicey and a bit much.
Yes.
Yet outside of that, it's the most real, hardworking, no bullshit place. If mm-hmm. you're full of shit, ain't nobody digging you in Chicago.
Right.
That's a fact. And also, Chicago's one of those, if you build it, they will come. Truly, you can put on a show in a little bar. It's going to get reviewed. And if people dig it, they're coming.
Right.
They're coming. So in Chicago, you just have to be a worker and care. And I don't know why people are born there that way, but it is. But politics is full of shit. Other than that, amazing.
It seems like that in the state of Illinois, it's not uncommon for political leaders to serve time in jail for corruption.
Yes. But and we've had our share of serial killers, you know, I don't want to even say their names, but everyone knows their names. That being said, it is just a hard work. The Midwest. Yeah. And you know what? Where also I find that feeling, and one of my favorite cities to gig is Nashville.
Mm-hmm.
Nashville, the difference is you really got to earn it because they've seen everything.
Yes, musically.
That vibe. Nashville, if I don't bring my A game, I'm dead. I am dead because that's, you got to earn it there. Chicago, they're more giving, but still they sense when you're full of shit or not.
Yeah, and they tell you. I've had great
Chicago,
and I've you know, for no fault of my own, it's just you weren't feeling well, and you mail some in, and
by the way, how can that not happen?
Yeah, exactly. I mean,
we're humans, you know. But by the way, imagine gigging in Kingston Mines as much as Joanna did. By the way, my favorite is blues.
Yeah,
and I across the street, and. I go in there, boy, the way it's packed in, the way it is, if you're not delivering mm-hmm. in that intimate setting, these people are going to be yammering, but yet they're all like, wow, wow.
Yeah.
There's Larry Bell. Look at him go.
Right.
You know?
I find dynamics in delivery makes people pay attention. If everything is at one pace or at one volume,
they'll get bored.
They get bored. The best applause I get every night is when I bring it down or I suck them in and they don't expect something, you know, like that what's going to come after. There are comedians that literally will just go up there and shout the act at you and it's at one level. And then there's some people that lower their, you know, the timbre of their voices. And it's a real art that I have the most.
Well, no, I would actually say it's a real craft.
Craft. Yeah.
That's where the craft comes in. But for me, I'll improvise from an outline. Like I literally will play a different song every night when I walk on stage, and then I'll discuss who's singing. It's usually something that's not a popular song or they might not know. And then I'll discuss it. I'll say what feelings it brings out. And that leads me on my set.
Right.
That's where I go. So some nights, especially when I'm relying on craft, there can be lulls and this sort of thing. But what I find fascinating is when a musician, and I don't want to mention names of bands or whatever, there are bands that I love that can't put together a running order to save their lives.
Yeah.
Whereas let's talk about the Rolling Stones. Mick Jagger singularly is in charge of the running order and he obsesses over it.
Right.
Obsesses over it. Because running order is, especially, you know, songs, yes, you might surprise yourself, surprise the audience. That running order doesn't stop you from doing that. But if you have the running order where you build that sort of thing in, wow, so you can do that. I'm 58 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I improvise my sets. I'm now about to go down the path. When I start in the fall, I'm going to be building an actual 45-minute to an hour show.
Right.
I believe I'm going to go on tour in in and or Australia and Europe, I've gotten offers and theaters.
Right.
I'm getting too old to make up shit. I mean, right. Not that I won't always. Like, if you have a right. running order, like, fellas, we're going to play this now instead. And your band's your band. They know what, you know, they'll go with it.
Yeah.
I'll always improvise, but I have to, at this point, stop. And I've been improvising for, like I said, I've been doing this 38 years. I have to have something. So when I'm 70 and I'm working still, which I want to, I can know when I go out what my set is. That doesn't mean I can't go off on a tangent. Doesn't right. mean I'm not. But by the way, when I go on stage, I'm truly myself and I'm a human being. So I'll yell for a while. I'll go down. The yelling is when I'm inspired.
Yeah.
The quiet is not when I'm trying to get them to come in, but just it calls for quiet. It calls for me to talk like this. And then can you believe that happened? Like, I've been complimented with weird compliments. And the two compliments I get, I'm the most relaxed comedian in the business, mm-hmm. which don't you want to be the most funny?
Right.
I've been rejected. And also, I'm one of the great comedic yellers in terms of my acting and stuff, because I yell and I can be funny yelling, which I've been told is art or skill. I take those both to heart. I always want to be the funniest
yeah.
and the best, but I'll take those. That's my skill set.
What do you think about comedy in the sense of, you know, I remember a few years back that Kevin Hart was one of the first comedians, and maybe even the only comedian, that ever headlined and sold out a stadium. And right. I said, that's an impressive feat of your popularity and your draw and how hot, you know, the comedian is. And I said to myself, I said, I wouldn't want to be sitting way in the back, because that's not, to okay. me, how okay. it's delivered. You know, is the venue makes a big difference. Am I correct?
Yes, without a doubt. I find comedy to be such an intimate art form. I think the blues are too. Mm-hmm. And don't forget, I saw you at what, the Pineapple, it's called, out in the West.
Mount Sugar Mill.
Yeah, with you and Jimmy Vivino.
Right.
And seeing you in the intimate setting is so, love it. And I don't know that I'd want to see you in Soldier Field.
Right.
I mean, I'd want to, knowing that you're doing great, making a lot of scratch for that night, all that. And I'm not saying you wouldn't have a great show. Kevin Hart, by the way, that's what, and by the way, I think Kevin Hart's funny and I love him. And he's also a really lovely guy,
yeah.
but that's his thing. He wants to be that big. It's about his draw. It's about, it's not, I'm sorry, but when you play Veterans Stadium, you can't have the funniest show in town. It's not going to happen because it's just too fucking big. I did this. Louis C.K. was playing the Forum, which is still a big fucking place for comedy. Okay.
12,000, yeah, 13,000.
Yeah. I saw Peter Frampton there somewhere in the middle. I bought tickets, his last tour.
Right.
Fantastic. Great for that. But comedy. So Louis gave me a ticket, fifth row center.
Yeah.
Two of them. I went by myself. I took those two tickets. I went to the last row of the Forum.
Right.
And I said to a couple sitting there, I said, hi. They go, Jeff Garland, which was, thank God. By the way, I don't ever give a shit about being recognized. I prefer not to. I'm a big fan of napping. But in this instance, because I was about to make them very fucking happy and I got credit for it, I gave them my fifth row center tickets and I took their last row of the Forum tickets and I watched Louis from the last row and I'm seeing this thing. I thought it really affected the thing, the response. It wasn't organic. Like, to me, I saw Rodney Dangerfield, George Carlin, numerous other people as a kid growing up in theaters that were 2,500 seats.
Yes.
And I thought, that's maxing out. That's, you don't want to in comedy. I don't think you can share the intimacies of comedy in anything bigger than, let's say, 3,000 seats. That would be max out for me. The first guy to do it, I know I'm talking a lot, but maybe you like that.
Oh, that's great.
The first guy to go bigger than anybody before was Eddie Murphy.
Right.
He was the first one that took it to stadium level or big. I mean, if he kept going, he could have played stadiums like Kevin Hart, you know. And who knows if he ever went on tour again, he could probably draw anything he wanted. So.
Well, that's the thing. It was like, you know, it was the 80s where the superstar comedians, the arena fillers, and then you started seeing like a lot of stuff that comes in my world. I'm like, I know who's blowing stuff up. I know where you got those screens and the lights and the PA and
yeah.
You know, and then I remember watching that movie, The Kings of Comedy, and then, you know, hearing about, you know, there was a Dice Clay did live from Madison Square.
Well, Dice Clay was the second one after Eddie that did Giant, because when he played The Garden, for example, that was a huge deal. Yep. Only Eddie had done that before. So now here's another guy doing it. It was like, wow, you know, and yes, that was 80s, early 90s.
And you know, it's to me, it's like, you know, I have a friend who's a comedy agent, and we were having dinner one time, and he told me, he goes, and I was just, you know, I asked him about the business, and there's a lot of parallels from music to comedy.
Of course.
It's the entertainment business.
Right. By the way, I do want to say for the record that when you're successful, comedy is much better to you than the, because you get fucked in the music industry, no matter how big you are, medium, doesn't matter. Comedy, you get fucked when you're not successful yet. You're treated like crap. You're not respected. It's just natural that way. But as you become more successful, you're treated, you get screwed over a lot less. But the music business, man, as much as you say, oh, I couldn't do the music business. Oh. There are so many shysters in your business that don't exist in movies, television, and stand-up comedy, where I'm like, wow. There's also great people that I know too, like behind the scenes and stuff. But overall, you know,
I had a concert promoter tell me one time, because, you know, you get paid, you get a basic guarantee, and then you get points if you sell out. So this is a place in Germany, and the guy goes, and you know, I knew how to read sold out in German, you know, I'm not a linguist, but I knew what it meant, you know. So I'm like, great, you know, we sold out gig, you know, we're gonna get a little points, a nice little taste at the end, no problem, right? Should have just been agreed upon. The place held, let's say, 500 people for easy math, right? Tour manager comes to me and goes, he's not gonna give us the points. And I'm like, really? I go, it said sold out, so pay us on the 500 seats. And then there's some back and forth. And finally, the promoter comes in. And he says, like, you know, he goes, Joel, your attendance was 401. And I said, well, I thought it was sold. He goes, well, the difference between your audience and some other audiences is that they're older and fat. That's what he told me.
Scumbag.
And I'm like, okay, you got me on that one. And then we started promoting our own shows. And you're like, ah, okay. And there's so much money left on the table. Not that it's all about the money, but again,
But by the way, we're professionals. This is what we do.
Right.
So don't tell me, you know, that someone's like, you should be happy with what you got, or which I've heard those before.
Yeah.
But by the way, when I was younger and every penny counted, and I'm supposed to get $400, they go, I'm only paying you $2 tonight. What are you going to do about it?
Right.
All the time. But as you grow, they don't ever try. No one tries screwing you later on.
And, you know, and it's different because, you know, I mean, my friend who's the comedy agent, he had a great line, and he told me, he goes, listen, you know, this was in 2019 when we had this conversation. He goes, listen, my comedians are one joke away from a Netflix special and one joke away from being canceled. All in the same night. He goes, it could be you're a hero and then you're out. And I'm like, man, I think that's
by the way, I know he said that, but in reality, that's not true. That's simplifying something.
Right.
You're not going to get canceled unless you're an out and out racist,
right?
A complete Nazi live in concert. Because people know it's comedy. So you're not going to get canceled. You might get canceled from something you tweet. You might get canceled from something you say on the street to TMZ. You won't from your show. And on the flip side, it's a year of killing And maybe Netflix will go, yeah, we've heard about her or him, whatever. Right. So that's simplifying it, but it is true because they're both, if you put in the work, you can get canceled and you can also be really successful.
Yeah, and it's because you're dealing with it's your thoughts, it's your emotions, it's your delivery, and they try to get a glimpse into your soul, and like you know, and sometimes you just want to go like, well, you know, maybe that's a character, you know,
but unfortunately for me, it's me when I go on stage. But yeah. I do Q&A towards the end, which could be risky, you know, in terms of what I might say. But I always say the same thing, and you'll understand this. I go, tonight I have, and if I haven't, I surely will momentarily say something stupid. Why? Because I'm a man. We say stupid shit. We think stupid shit. But one thing I'm not is ignorant. And I will not say anything tonight that you would record, play for somebody, and go, I didn't know Jeff Garland was hateful. I didn't know Jeff Garland was racist. No, right. That won't happen. That's impossible. Because right. My mind doesn't work that way. I'm not going to go there. But I will say something stupid. I always do. Always. Can't help it. Men, we say stupid things. Always.
Is it important to push the barrier though? Is it important to try to get it, you know, not say hateful racist things, but to be edgy
I want to clarify that. I'm following what you're saying. Mm-hmm. In terms of edginess, are you being edgy to be edgy or are you trying to be funny? If you're trying to be funny and have a point, but the point's got to be secondary. Right. They have to be laughing to absorb if there is a message. So if it's funny, I don't think it's a problem. But so that whole pushing the envelope, it's like, you know what, besides not being funny, one of my pet peeves, besides the term pet peeve, that I can't stand is when comedians or television shows or movies try being clever. Right. Clever is an enemy of comedy. So yeah. If you're up there being clever and people go, oh, how about that? You're not doing your job.
Right.
You're supposed to be there you can enlighten, but that's secondary to being funny. That's why somebody like Rodney could go up and they're all jokes and you know they're jokes. And then there's other people who like Robin Williams would say funny things and jokes, but he also had some messages that he wanted to get out. But it's right. All mixed in with his brilliance. So right. I'm not a big believer in someone pushing the envelope. I think do what you do. And if the envelope is pushed, all the more power to you.
Right. And it's natural. You know, it's it's the same thing with music. It's like if you're trying to be clever for the sake of like trying to get the respect of the 10 musician buddies that you have.
Well, you did that video I saw about the worst possible thing that you can play, which might be impressive for moving. That was recent, wasn't it?
My series of Jobo's pro tips,
which and that was in there. Yeah, someone might go, "Oh, he's fast. What the fuck does that mean?" It's the nuance of playing. Are you Wes Montgomery or are you some guy in a club? Which you're like, get me the fuck out of here. He's so skilled, but fuck him. You know, right. Where you watch Wes and you go, oh, like you're amazed and you're like in a dream world.
It hits your soul. It has to, you know, the right.
It has to hit your soul.
Right.
And by the way, when people come see me do comedy, I want them to leave the show not only satisfied, but with a piece of me to feel like I got him. And I feel that when I see great musicians, I feel a piece of them. Not that I know them, but they've given me their soul in their playing.
Right.
Beautiful, beautiful.
You know, a few of my friends have had this conversation recently about like the new world, you know, the people are taping and it's a different world, social media and everything. And I said, you know, one of the things I feel sorry for the younger generation of musicians, comedians and stuff like that is they cannot leave the bad gigs on the stage and in the room. It's
a terrible place to be a young comedian. That's all I can speak from. Yeah. And you also a terrible show as a stand-up. But that's why you don't, let's say you're a young comic and for whatever reason, you get a stand-up gig on a national talk show. First off, it's not as big. It used to be your Roseanne Barr at the time, and you go on The Tonight Show. The next day, you're a huge star.
Right.
Those days are long behind us. But I've always believed don't do anything until you're ready, like really, really ready. And that's why it's really good when you're starting out to do shows that are not well attended, not talked about. Play the underbelly, like get good where the least amount of, it's like a strategy that I didn't have to worry about and you didn't have to worry about.
Right.
But performers today, they got to worry about being seen before their time. And Lord knows if they, with cancel culture, you make a mistake.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah. You just, it, you know, and it's, there's not the woodshedding part of the craft or and the art isn't there because everybody's expecting it to be perfectly polished, you know, either Netflix ready or Madison Square.
Why we're not gonna see as many great comedians in the future as we have in the past. Right. Because people can't develop. You can see sparks and maybe that'll lead to an acting career, but you're not going to see the Dave Chappelle's of the world who were allowed to bomb and no one knew when they were bombing and growing.
Yeah, and you leave your mistakes on the stage. That's what I love about live performing is you know what? You're only as good as your last gig, and I take solace in the fact that March 12th, 2020, we played Milwaukee at the Riverside Theater, and we were fucking good. Our band was fucking good. And that was my last show in front of people. And I said, you know, if it's it, I'm out.
Well, by the way, imagine your last show bombing or, you know, I can say bombing to you even a shitty show where you, by the way, so, this is really funny. People ask me about bombing. We're talking about bombing. There are nights where it's not my fault. My groove is going. They're just not into me. Whatever they had for dinner, whatever their day of work was like, whatever their significant others, how they treated them. You know, it's an audience is like an organism, you know. And there's some nights where I'm grooving and I'm like, oh, fuck. Go to my craft, do the best I can. But the nights that kill me are when I go up and they're ready and I suck. Holy shit, does that beat the crap out of me. I cannot function until I get on stage again because I sucked. And that is the worst thing. So to go out into Coronaville and have your last show be one where you sucked, wow, would that be?
It's unfinished business. And the reason why I like touring is because of if I was terrible the night before, making stupid mistakes, fundamentals, you know, like stuff you played a million times, you're distracted, whatever, just not in it, just you, the stars didn't align. I always, you know, if that's Monday, I got Tuesday to redeem myself. It's like it's one step and repeat. It's You're just going, oh my God, you're celebrated, and then you're redeemed if you're not, you know. And I love that rhythm, you know.
Well, by the way, that Tuesday night crowd, that's the crowd I want to be in where the night before it wasn't so great, because you're gonna fucking tear it up. You take great, and I said it was a bad thing, pride in what you do.
Yes.
You know. Yeah.
Question. You use the word craft. Can you tell the audience, like just a few, like, okay, I got to use the craft tonight. What is
it? Well, there's a craft in filmmaking. There's a craft in everything that I do. And the craft is almost like the rules.
Right.
Like, I mean, the rules, look at B.B. King. He didn't know any chords. So I don't know what he did when he had to go for something else, but knowing the chords is part of your craft. Knowing how to do the fingers, but having that be second, not even in your head, I know what I'm doing as I play.
Yeah.
That's the craft of knowing. It's almost like within the rules, like here's my craft. Here's how I know how to do it. Here's what I've learned. The art is how you bend it, how you become Joe Bonamassa, how you become B.B. King. You take what's there, what everyone learns, and you go, now I make it my own. Right. Now I bend it this way and bend it that way. Not even consciously trying to bend, you're just true to yourself.
Right.
So the craft is the, and you can't do that unless you know the craft. Right. The craft of acting. I can't do things with acting if I don't know how to act, if I haven't figured that out. Same with stand-up, like all of it. The craft is the basics, but knowing them so you don't even think about them, that's knowing your craft. I hope that made sense.
It does make sense. And there's a thing, though, I always say the last 10% of any performer's, you know, success is the undefinable quality, the star quality.
Mm-hmm.
And because I know people that want it so bad, they have it all. They have studied the craft. They have done the homework. They can play, they can write, they can sing. And there's something that doesn't connect with the audience. And then they see this bozo with a weird last name selling out, you know, Albert Hall. And they're like, well, what is it? And I'm not saying I'm a star, but I also learned from performers, and I learned from folks that when I see Buddy Guy walk out, okay, B.B. King, Paul Rogers, Eric Clapton, whatever, they don't have to do anything other than smile, and they have the crowd in the palm of their hands. They're in control.
But that can't be taught. That cannot be taught. That is the separate. I had people, I remember in acting class, there was this one guy in my college acting class, I'll never forget. He had all of it. He could, not all of it, but I mean, he was such a finite, beautiful actor, amazing. He had zero on charisma. It's fucking zero on charisma. Right. So I said, I hope there's a supporting role where he doesn't need to have charisma, because that dude will not be a star. It's just not in the cards. Yeah. Whereas, by the way, the flip of that is when you see some pop stars or some actors or actresses, and you know they're not really great at what they do, but they have boatloads of fucking charisma, that pulls you through. The best artists, the ones that you want to see, are the ones who have the craft, the artistry, and the quality. But right. That's not handed out right and left. That's not, you know, it's all a journey and figuring it out. But that's the part that you cannot teach.
Yeah, and you can explain it to somebody, and if they don't understand it, be like, but wait a minute, I studied this, and I have charisma. Like, no, you study charisma. It's like, can you take the air out of a room? Can you just at the drop of a hat entertain people? You know, because we are in the entertainment business.
That's right. A
gigantic umbrella. You know,
right.
You were hanging. You know, Second City. I read that you and Stephen Colbert were like ticket takers, or worked the
box? We weren't ticket takers, but we worked in the box office of Second City together.
Right.
And I remember his first day, I looked at him and went, who's this guy? And I went, I wonder what he's here for. I didn't know, you know. Yeah. And then he's become, and by the way, I saw him on stage at Second City and I knew why he was there. He was great. The one guy at Second City when I was there where you just couldn't deny that he was a star was Steve Carell.
Right.
Steve Carell. But here's the thing about, you know, nobody was talking about him. Like, I'm in the audience going, oh my God. Like, I couldn't believe I'm laughing so hard. Why is no one talking about this guy? Why? Right. Because there's at Second City, this was really bad. Jealousies, you know, and everyone's got their own agenda. Look next to you and there's Steve Carell, who's amazing.
Right.
You know, I love my two favorite comedians are Richard Pryor and Jack Benny. And one thing that Jack Benny was known for was being the hardest laugher at other comedians. That's what I take pride in. Man, right. If you're funny, I love to grab my stomach and laugh.
Right.
I just watched Brian Regan's Netflix special. It just came out. And Damn, if at least a half dozen times I didn't grab my stomach from something that he did. I started with him, by the way. And so I'm really happy every time I see him. But he makes me laugh hard, you know?
And that's it. You know, it's kind of the parallel in blues. It is probably the most argued about form of guitar playing, and you know, well, at least in my world. And it's like, you know, I root for kids because the more people involved in the community, the stronger the community is. It's like there's only one Eric Gales, there's only one Joanna Connor, there's only one, whoever. You just like people have made their lanes and have made the marks in their careers. So there's room for everybody. It's not
there's
like
a lot of really good young players though that I see and know. Tyler, you know.
Tyler.
Yeah, he's great. And what's the kid from England, the young kid who reminds me of you? Toby.
Yeah.
I gigged with him at a Gibson show, the Gibson comeback show. Remarkable. I mean, remarkable. And by the way, both sweet kids. And how about Kingfish?
Kingfish is great.
I hosted his birthday party. His birthday show here in L.A. before COVID. And I was so honored. And he's such a sweet kid, Mr. Garland, he called me. Like, what a sweetie. But watching him play, my God, thank you. It's still going. You know, it's like jazz and blues. I want to be inspired. I do root for the people. But it's an art form that the masses never jump. You're the most successful blues artist by what we call a country mile. Because people who don't necessarily love the blues go to your shows. And I'm not cutting on them for that, but you get a lot of mainstream music people who come to see you, which to me, hurrah. By the way, if every show you convince a dozen people to dig into John Lee Hooker or Buddy Guy.
It's a win. It's a total win.
Huge win, you know.
I always say the guy in the suit and the sunglasses for any budding musician is proof of concept. I can do it. You can do it. It's that simple. And you can
do it, but you may not do it as well as you do it, but you can do it. And I agree with you.
You could, if you have a dream and you have the chutzpah to go get that dream.
Yep.
You know, and it's important because it's not like, well, you know, it's like, well, like, well, look what Joe Bonamassa's got. It's like, it doesn't matter. I start off my room just like everybody else with a damn guitar and a copy of Stevie Ray's Texas Flood and Jimi Hendrix Experience going, I don't know what this is, but I want in on it, you know? And I work.
How did you not end up? I can I ask you a couple questions now?
Sure, come on.
Okay. How did you not end up? And I know you collect everything and you have everything and you play everything, but you're a Les Paul guy.
Yes.
That's your modus operandi. I am not accomplished enough. Here's my problem with me playing. I will play, get mediocre, and that's not cutting on me. It's just a fact. I'm a comedian. That's what my skill set is.
Right.
I'll get mediocre, but the minute I have to film for a month straight, mm-hmm. I forget everything, and I'm back at square one with my teacher. Like even learning chords, even learning the fingerboard, all of that. So I have Les Pauls, I have 335s, I have Strats, I have Tellys. That's pretty much my thing, but I have a bunch of them. I don't know which one I favor. I know what I kind of love 335s and Tellys, but mm-hmm. I don't know that I'm not going to end up being a softie. I bought that 59 hardtail Strat.
Nice.
I traded actually. I completely traded for some other guitars. But the point is, how did you not end up a Strat guy? What moved you, especially starting with Hendrix and Stevie Ray, what moved you to Les Paul? And not that you don't still use a Strat, but you know what I mean?
Little Rock, Arkansas. I was opening up for a band called Indigenous at the time. Yeah. And, you know, I'm an opening act, okay? And I have 35, 45 minutes. And I'm also making $150, $250 from the promoter. And I got hotels for two guys in a crew, in a van.
You're losing money to learn how to play.
If I don't sell CDs in between the sets, which is the fat part of the night between right. the opener, that half hour, that's where you're going to do all your business. If I don't sell CDs, I'm out of business. And I used to have this little piece that I did. I was predominantly a Strat guy and a Fender guy. I mean, like, most of my collection is Fender.
Right.
And I bought a Strat today in the parking lot of Soundcheck in Nashville. The guy just shows up with it. I'm like, hey, great.
Which one did you buy?
I bought a 63 hardtail Strat that he found. You know, yeah. he knew where to go.
I'm a big fan of hardtails, just want to say. Okay,
I love them. I don't use the trend. So I used to have this little classical bit that I would do with the volume control and a delay pedal. It sounded like a cello or a violin, and it would get people to get quiet, and then they would, you know, and then we'd go into a slow blues, and we'd get a big round of applause. It was a gimmick. It was a gimmick. It was like a piece off, like, amalgamation of like a Bach melody and some stuff.
When you're an opening act, you have to make your way through and learn that it's, by the way, you look back now and say it was a gimmick, but I bet you back then when you were doing it, you thought this is cool. It's going to get them.
And it's going to get them. And my job was and no offense to anybody I've ever opened up. My mission in life was to siphon off as many of their fans to become Joe Bonamassa fans as I could. And
right.
In a 35-minute period. And I would end my set early on purpose, so I'd go sell CDs for another 5 minutes. Anyway, I did this thing, and the last guy in the CD line, we killed. We sold like 100 CDs that night. It was great. It was like, you know, an extra couple of $1,000. And the last guy in the line, he came up to me. He's like, man, you know that thing that when you played, it sounded like a violin? I'm like, yeah. I thought he recognized where I nicked it from. Right, because he was talking very intelligently about it, and it was almost like a bit, like his comedic timing was quite excellent, because the setup was great, and he goes, you know that thing that you did, man, it was really eloquent, really well put together, you know, I really loved it, you know, when you went into that, it sounded to me just like Stevie Ray Vaughan, and I said, oh
fuck.
I go, thank you, sir, you know, I took the compliment, and as we're driving in the van. It's like it's that moment is replaying in my mind. And I said, that's when I first realized about 20 years ago that people hear with their eyes. It's because I was playing it on a Strat that he associated Strat with Stevie Ray. It doesn't matter if I was doing Latvian polkas up there, okay? It would have sounded like Stevie Ray Vaughan to him. And I said, and on that tour, I ended up going to play in Gibson Showroom in Memphis. And as a token gift, they gave me a Les Paul. And I started doing the exact same bit on the Les Paul. I figured out how to use the front pickup instead of the back. And it never happened to me again. And I said, ding, 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 ding. If I'm going to get my own lane here, I need to somehow shift the instrument and become an artist. It will become an act that is remembered for something that's not perceived as being derived from someone else.
Someone else. And by the way, those motivations kept Clapton going all the years. Like whenever he would get typecast, he'd go, no, I have to be my own voice. And that's why he would change guitars, ultimately, ironically, to a Strat. But Freddie King, who besides Freddie King in the 50s, because he later went to, I believe, a 345. I know a 345. Who else blues-wise is known for a Les Paul? Blues. I know Joanne is. I'm talking about the classic blues men.
Well, there's pictures of B.B. King in the 50s.
Yeah, but do a thing. You are established as a Les Paul. Who else in blues is established as a Les Paul that's really known?
Well, Mike Bloomfield was a Les Paul.
Bloomfield went to, by the way, I know like you. That's why I belong in Nerdville.
Like me, yeah.
Also, being a Jew from Chicago, Mike Bloomfield is one of my all-time favorites, what he did with Dylan and stuff. And I know he had the 64 Tele, and then he loved the Les Paul. And then because of drugs and the world he was in, he just grabbed whatever he could grab. But yeah, Mike Bloomfield. So it's a short list. Keep going. Anyone else?
Hubert Sumlin.
But he also was a Strat. I think he was equally a Les Paul / Strat guy. I think. Am I wrong?
My show in San Francisco, the Palace of the Fine Arts. This was years ago. He was like, hey, Hubert Sumlin is going to come. I was like, oh my God. Dude, royalty.
Royalty.
And I asked him, I said, you still got the Les Paul, the gold top or whatever. It was some guitar he had. And he goes, yeah, I'm, he goes, Joe, I'm actually a Les Paul guy. I go, I play the Fenders because they give them to me. I'm like, good on you. He goes, good, man. Huber was, like, all those guys, it's just like, are you going to pay me to play this thing or not? You know, I mean, and...
Well, that's why, and I don't want to say names here at all, and I'm talking about guitarists, numerous guitarists I know will take deals and play certain guitars that are not Gibson or Gretsch or Fender, you know, with the classics. They go into these other ones because they're getting paid.
Right.
And you know,
I can't be that guy.
Ball or whatever is paying them, you right. know, to, you know.
I can't be that guy. I find it would be disingenuous to my audience.
Well, it's disingenuous to yourself.
In charity.
Oh, even Springsteen plays, I mean, he's tight with his telly, but he plays that his acoustics are that Japanese company.
Takamine.
There's no way a Takamine is better than a fucking Martin or a Gibson. Sorry, I'll wrestle anyone.
Yeah,
who
I mean, it's you know, it's again, it's like I watched, like, you know, my favorite players use them as tools. So like, so when I play a Les Paul, it's because I have a Les Paul sound in my mind for this song.
Right.
If I play or Strat. And you know, the way I can have relationships with both Fender and Gibson, I always tell Gibson, I go, listen, guys, you're not going to lose me, okay? And I go, you may not want to endorse me. I don't care. I said, but you think I'm going to show up with a Paul Reed Smith the next day? No, because I'm
not. No offense to Paul Reed Smith. That's their thing.
No offense to Paul. And the same thing with Fender. So that's why I kind of like one of the few people that actually has deals with both companies, because they know, you know, this I have
to
this one. It's not. I couldn't do the gig with one. I couldn't do the gig with one.
What's his name? Blues Power. What's his name?
James Nichols.
Jay, it was a friend, a dear friend. By the way, one of the sweetest guys on earth.
Absolutely.
Such a sweetheart. So. He's Gibson, 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 Gibson. He's got his own custom Epiphone, but Gibson, Gibson, Gibson. I give him your...
the telly.
Yeah, the telly with the... Because his hands... I mean, I've got pretty big hands. His hands are bigger than mine. That, I told you, that neck was ridiculous. I'm like, when did Fender have a neck like this? And you're like, I don't know about how they made them. I don't look, they're not on sale anymore. You can say what you want, but I gave it to him. But before we go into that part of it, he was like, well, what's Gibson going to think of me? I go, their opinion's not going to change. If you're playing this telly ever in your shows, you're going to be fine. Just let them know this song calls for a telly. They know you love Gibson.
Yeah.
You know?
And I know people that have exclusive deals with companies that they cannot be seen playing anything other than that brand. And I understand why musicians take those deals, because, you know, everybody's got to make a living and it's tough to earn money. And also the profile could be raised with ads and stuff like that. Totally understand, but I would feel suffocated, like, knowing that somebody social media to see if they can spot an off-brand guitar somewhere in the damn, you know.
Well, by the way, I think artistically and craft-wise, if you sign with one company, it holds you back. That's my opinion.
Yeah,
your opinion too, obviously.
Well, that's true. I mean, it's a way of doing things. One of the things I want to ask you about. Because this is a subject.
And I have one more thing I want to ask you.
Oh, go ahead.
Do you want to close with it? Because I know we've been on for over an hour.
Close with your question. I have one thing that's like, okay. it's a thing that I've struggled with myself, and it's an issue that I'm very passionate about. And by the way, you look great. And I've had weight management problems my whole life.
Okay.
And I read a quote that you summed up basically my diet and regime and routine perfectly. And you're one of the few people that have ever explained it in this way. It was a quote about, I haven't had sugar in 3 years, because if I have a cookie or a peanut M&M, it's going to kick in this addiction thing, and then it's going to go right back. And it's something that I've talked to many people on this program about, because people outside appearances like, oh no, you could do this and do that, but it's a real struggle, and it's a lifelong struggle, and it's a lifestyle that is.
Well, you are nailing it. And for me, I started in comedy when I was 20. So I've been doing comedy for 38 years. Right. And truly, when I was on the road, no alcohol, no coke, and I saw people die from both of them, right. Even famous people that we know I was close with.
Right.
I saw lots of people die from this. My addiction, sugar. I would have Fruity Pebbles, Puddin' Pops, Pop-Tarts, cupcakes, ice cream, all in the condo that the club put me up at. I couldn't feed myself enough.
Right.
It was a hole. When I approached it like an addiction by stopping eating sugar per se, the biggest thing that I learned, and this is it's the only thing I know about this, truly. I lost almost 100 pounds without dieting.
Right.
Hear those words? Without dieting. No dieting. Yes, I eliminated sugar and a lot of junk, common sense. But when I feel something, especially if it's negative, sometimes positive, but especially if I'm feeling something that I'm not comfortable with in any aspect of my life, I sit in the chair and I feel it. And it could go for a minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 2 hours, 2 days. You have to sit with your feelings. And the joke of it all is, it doesn't get easier. It's not like when you're learning guitar, this is so hard. And then one day it kicks in and you're like, yeah, look at me, motherfuckers.
Right.
No, sitting with your feelings sucks the same on day 5,000 as it does on day one. It just sucks. So right. I sit with my feelings. Therefore, I'm not filling myself up with shit to make myself numb. And yeah. Also, as you know, with food, the numbing only works for, like, at first, if I ate a pint of ice cream when I was younger, I feel good for a long time, not knowing how I was destroying and ravaging my body.
Right.
But as I got older, the more I did it, might last 5 minutes, 3 minutes where I felt numb, and then it kicks in and I'm like, and I'm gonna tell you a story right now, very quickly. The other day I'm filming a scene on the Goldbergs, and I didn't really pay attention that I had to do this scene. And I'm sitting in this restaurant with the girl, Haley Arantia, who plays my daughter, and they put a cake down at a certain point, and she's real upset because it's her and her boyfriend on the cake. He had arranged the dinner. I'm the substitute. And I take from the cake, and I go, you don't have to worry about it anymore. I take a thing and I shove it in my mouth and rub it into my face to hopefully make her laugh, but show her I'm destroying the cake.
Right.
The prop master who's in charge of the cake and knows me well, because usually, like, if you watch Curb or the Goldbergs and you see me eating dinner,
right.
my plate has little cut up pieces of cantaloupe, watermelon,
right.
Black olives, like little teeny things. I don't get into them. He made a cake that was sugar-free and gluten-free.
Right.
So I do the thing, and I thought it would be fine. It goes in my mouth, and I'm like, see, you don't have to worry about the cake anymore. I'll be damned if it didn't hit me hard.
Right.
Hard.
Right.
And I had to do it 4 more times. I went home. By the way, it didn't knock me off the wagon. Mm-hmm. But I went home with some feelings that were not pleasant, and they lasted. I didn't sleep a wink that night. I felt like shit. So I knew what to do. I went with my feelings. I didn't go out and buy a real cake, because
right.
if I ate a real cake, it's over. It's over. If I have a cupcake, it's done. So even something sugar-free and gluten-free. Well, it's like an alcoholic drinking non-alcoholic beer. If you imagine drinking a six-pack of that, it's going to bring back feelings. Even if you're not drunk, it'll bring back feelings.
Well,
so that was a tough one.
I know some people that have had sobriety issues their whole life, and I know there's the wagon. There ain't no brackish waters in the wagon.
Sometimes... Like that night, I was on the wagon, but hanging on the side.
Yeah.
I could have easily fallen off the wagon, but I climbed back on, you know?
Yeah, and it's like you can't take it, you know, you can't take a, you know, if you have trouble with alcohol management or any management, food, it's not, you can't have a shot of limoncello at Christmas and not go, well, that the world didn't end, you know? And
cannot.
Because it's going to escalate into something else. And it's, and I just thought when I read that quote, it was something, because I don't have food in my house. Because you know what happens when food is in my house, and or somebody brings me something, you know, they're being thoughtful. It's like, hey, you know, like I know you're not here very often, but here I brought you like some cookies or whatever. Or like, you know, I go, I cannot accept it. He goes, well, just put it in your cupboard and forget about it. I go, you don't understand. I know it's there. And
it overwhelms you.
And it's a comment on Instagram. It's some nonsense in a day. And I'm like, there I am. You know, with the peanut and M&Ms once again, you know, and then, you know, I gained.
Well, my friend, and that, first off, one step number one, don't read comments, because majority of that is somebody living in their mother's basement, right. And they're just angry that they're in their mother's basement. So don't look there, because you're never going to, you will never grow from comments. You might grow, and I have grown when I used to read reviews of my movies. I don't anymore. Movies that I made, that I wrote and directed, but I don't anymore. I read nothing. I just do what I do, because man, the world is tough enough than to dive into that area, especially comments. But all you gotta do, what's that?
They're just trying to make you feel as bad as they did.
And what does that lead to? Your addiction.
It does.
And your addiction and my addiction is food. The thing which separates it from drugs and alcohol is you have to have food during the day for nourishment, three times a day at least.
Yeah.
You know, and that is the joke on people who overeat. And also it's the one that nobody respects. I mean, this is actually, it's a bit, but it's not a bit. You know, you're in a nightclub. Women see someone smoking weed, snorting coke, and they might want to fuck him. Nobody's looking at a guy in the corner eating donuts and go, man, he's hot. No one does that, ever, you know? So it's the one thing that is... So I want to ask you this question. Do you have another one with that? Is there a follow-up with that?
I would say my only two addictions are food and what you're seeing hanging on the wall.
Well, by the way, that's where I'm at, and I want to talk to you about this. First off, I guess that the only way, even when I'm filming something, I got to force myself. I want to, but no matter how tired I am at night or early in the morning, to do at least 10, 20 minutes on the guitar, right?
Right.
Okay, mm-hmm. That's a common sense one.
Yeah.
The other one is, I like you, well, you're a guitarist, and you know that's what Nerdville is, the guitar and amps. I started buying everything. I had a 53 all original Tele. I still have my, what I've done in my collection of guitars is I get something that I love that's valuable, but it was refretted.
Right.
Or there was someone removed the whammy bar and put in a tail on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I get something great. What are your thoughts on, because I want to play everything, which you do too.
Yeah.
I remember when I saw you at the Pineapple Lounge or whatever the name of the place is.
Sugar Mill, yeah.
You were playing like a $300,000 guitar.
I was.
And I said, how do you do that? You said, it's got to be played. It was just a matter of fact, it's got to be played.
Yeah.
And it was beautiful to see and wonderful to hear. What are your thoughts on, and this is not to begrudge my friends, and they are my friends at Gibson. That's who I'm affiliated with. They don't pay me. I have no affiliation with Fender whatsoever, but I love Tellies and Strats. What are your thoughts on not the custom shop? Because the custom shops, at least Fender-wise, are just a better made guitar. But what are your thoughts on master builds? And I know Gibson Custom Shop, they don't do master build type things. Their custom shops are just their custom shops, which are, to me, Gibson are, I've always said, and I imagine you've thought this or I said it, Gibsons are works of art and a tool. Whereas right. Tellys are amazing tools. I mean, well, Fender are amazing tools, but I don't look at them as works of art. Like if I see a West Montgomery L5, I can just look at that for 20 minutes.
And I'm like, wow. To put the binding on it and to bend the wood.
All of it. Yeah. He
was a working man's manufacturer. I mean, he was, these are guitars for average Joes that we could sell to the masses. He didn't realize, I don't think he realized at the time how revolutionary that concept was. He wasn't even a player. He was a radio guy. He was an amp builder.
Right.
Genius amp builder. My thoughts is this. I can show you a $300,000 guitar. I can show you a $600,000 guitar. And it's all, if you're right-handed, it's about the left hand. If you're left-handed, it's about the right hand. If you got it sitting next to you, no matter what it's worth, it could be worth $200, $500, whatever, priceless. If the DNA in your body doesn't reach for that said guitar, that's not the instrument for you. And one of my biggest, the advice I give to collectors, I said, don't let other people spend your money. And I said, don't let the internet spend your money. You need to have the right ear for this is blah, 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 blah. You know what the right ear is? It's the guitar that you love and bond with. And right. It could be at any price point. I mean, look at how everyone from like Hound Dog Taylor, Jack Pearson here in Nashville. Right. Jack plays a $200 Squire. Okay. He'll make you cry with it, but that's what he prefers, you know? And I gave him one of my Amos Flying Vs, the Epiphone ones, and he loved it because he played on Reese Winans's record. And he goes, and I just gave it to him. And he goes, man, what do I owe you? I said, you owe me one video from your bebop gig with the V. Next week, there he was, shredding bebop, you know? And like over these, you know, on the Flying V.
So what you're saying, if I may, is it doesn't matter whether it's a beginner Fender all the way through their Masterbuilt, all the way to a $600,000 guitar. If any of those, well, obviously you have to have the money for the $600,000, but if whatever floats your boat in terms of the playing, that's the guitar for you.
Right.
And I think about the expensive ones, but for me, just because it's a Masterbuilt built by a great master builder and I like it and it looks like it'll work, unless it really jams into me, no.
No. And you know, I serve both masters. Now there are the Nerdville is a double faceted, multifaceted operation. Okay, there's the stuff that I play on, there's the 40 or 50 guitars that I own that are constant rotation. It's what I play, it's what I use live, blah, they're all old ones. Okay, and then there's the museum part of it. Now, I don't have a big enough ego to take a perfect 1954 Strat that looks like it was built yesterday and then it run 100 shows on it. Now it's got a few things and some neckwear and stuff like that because I appreciate the history and I like being a custodian for that for another generation to appreciate.
Which is beautiful, yes.
You know, and the sometimes the people who are not into collecting or ones that just don't get what I'm trying to say is like, it's like, well, every guitar should be played and it should be out gigging. I'm like, not this one. There's plenty of Strats, you know, like my Tweed Amp collections, arguably the best in the world. I have about 50, actually more than that. I have about 75 pristine Fender Tweed amps from the mid to late 50s. All like they look like they came out of the factory yesterday and they're all factory. Not they're not reconditioned. And they're like, well, it's a shame that they just sit there and are not making music and playing shows. I go, there's plenty of other amps you could play through at the show. Why are you beating up this thing that is literally a time capsule and deserves to be preserved and admired for its ingenuity and how far ahead all this stuff was.
Well, that's why I try and buy an older guitar that's got some sort of flaw that a collector wouldn't want. I don't really like when they're refinished, but outside of refinishing, I'm or even touch up even, I'm good, you know, because I'm getting the bargain on this beautiful thing that I can play.
Right.
Do you play that Strat or those amps in your own homes? Or
fire them up.
So they're being played the same way I would play them. I don't have a gig where I'm, you know, got to have 40 guitars and, you know, someone's bringing them to me. So they're not they're not going to waste, and they're being preserved because you can take the proper care of them in your air-conditioned, beautiful home.
Yeah, and it's, you know, I play them, and I'll get them out every day if I'm home, you know, which has been a lot lately. I mean, I just go out to the vault and, you know, pull one out and be like, hey, I haven't seen this one in a while. And then, you know, spend the day, you know, admiring it and bonding with it. And there's a reason why I bought it in the first place, you know.
You can even record with it, too, and be safe.
You could totally record with it. And it's, you know, again, it's beauty is, you know, beholden in its beholder. You know, and it's linked, you know, like there's a, you know, my concern, it's not really a concern because I don't care. I mean, I'll die with this stuff, but, and then my niece and nephew got to deal with it. That's another story. But, I look at a maple neck Stratocaster, a Sunburst Les Paul, and I go, Buddy Holly, Mike Bloomfield, Jimmy Page, Clapton, you know, I name associate.
Yeah.
When the name association attached to the instruments starts to erode the undercurrent, when you go up to a kid and be like, man, that's a cool Buddy Holly Strat. And they go, who the hell's Buddy Holly? That's going to happen. And that's going to happen sooner than we think. It's going to happen in the next 10, 20 years.
I'm sure it's already happening with that. And by the way, you're doing the kid a favor by mentioning Buddy Holly, where to me, the Beatles don't exist without Buddy Holly.
Oh, and you know, my friend Dion, who was on, he was on that gig. He was at the Surf Ballroom in you know, Clear, was it Clear Lake, Iowa? And you know, he direct link to the founding fathers of that rock and roll. And there's Buddy Guy is a direct link to the founding fathers of Chicago and electrified blues. And you know, he hung with you know, Howlin' Wolf. He played on those sessions. He's a session guy. And, you know, so my job as a collector is to preserve a snapshot in time between 1950 and 1965 when this country, not to sound like all super patriotic, every screw and nut bolt, everything was built here. And
yeah,
it was built by middle class people like my parents. And somebody had a great idea and conquered the world. So that's why I collect.
Well, I love that, and that's beautiful. I have one last question, which is, so you've got a place in New York, a place in Nashville, and you live right by me here.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have a favorite, and how do you do the three places? Like, how do you maneuver that?
A lot of my Nashville stuff is for work. My band is based here. A lot of my logistical stuff here. And plus, I just actually like Nashville.
Nashville's fantastic. I love Nashville.
And I got into Nashville before the explosion of everybody coming from, you know, I was one of the original problems, you know, and they call us problems, you know, California. And, you know, Jeff, all I can tell you is I'm a blues guitar player with a funny last name, been in the game 31 years. Sold 9 million records and have gone through 4 passports. I'm lucky. I worked hard, but I'm lucky. It doesn't work out that way for everybody. I don't apologize for it because I know the amount of time and sweat equity and ingenuity that went into all
of
this.
You've got nothing to apologize for. You are all you got. I always tell people the two things that you need to survive in what we do is competence and humbleness. To be grateful for all the opportunities, all the things that you can do, and confident in what people are giving you money for, what people are looking to you for. Right. That if you know you can do that, where does ego fit in? Nowhere. Completely unnecessary. Completely unnecessary. Confidence mixed with humbleness, a beautiful thing. So you got nothing to ever apologize for.
You know, I don't feel entitled to anything other than what I work for. And then
right, and congratulations.
You know, and I really try to ultimately, you know, I give back. I mean, we raised $400,000+ last year for musicians. We helped 231 bands, give them a check for $1,500, you know, and I'd rather do that then
that's the way I think too. I'm always involved with giving away with chairs. Matter of fact, I'm involved with a charity called Fuck Cancer, and that's literally what it's called. I love it. Right. And it's a thing for people to learn about stuff and also to help families who are going through it. It's not research, but anyhow, I have one of those master built Clapton Blind Faith guitars.
Oh yeah,
He signed the cert, and it's a Tele body with a Strat 57 soft V neck, right, which I thought would be my dream guitar. Point being is, it's mint, brand new. I donated it to my charity. They're going to auction it off.
Yeah.
They're going to, and that thrills me. You know?
It's going to do a lot of good, you know?
Well, giving is just such a, by the way, to be able to be in a position to give. Hooray. Mm-hmm. Wow. Right.
It's the best thing we've ever done is raise that money last year. I believe it. My whole career, if somebody said, pick the one thing that you were involved with, that's the best thing you ever said. I said, you know what? Helping bands of, not just blues bands, just anybody, you know? You had a gig,
When you're little, every Christmas special always has that thing about giving is better than receiving. And you're a little kid going, what? I'd rather get toys than give them away. But when you become a man or a woman, whatever, you go, giving feels so much better than receiving. Oh my God, it is just joyful. That is all I'm about now.
Right.
I look at every opportunity. Will this bring me joy in terms of giving, in terms of the work? Will it bring me joy? And by the way, my friend, you bring me joy.
Well, I appreciate that, Jeff. I'm going to end with a celebrity question. I went to my friend Jimmy Vivino.
Yes. And by the way, you know, we had to stop because of COVID. I couldn't do it. But once I get my shots, we have a show for Gibson TV that we're doing together, which is, and the first one was just he and I having a conversation like this. But you're like right away, like, I think we have Elliot Easton was supposed to be our first guest. You were going to be our second guest. Oh. You didn't know that because we didn't have you. But go ahead. About Rubino. Go ahead.
He kept it real simple. Because, you know, he's a musicologist and, you know.
Without a doubt.
Kept it real simple. And he goes, just ask Jeff, Chicago pizza or New York pizza?
For me personally?
Yeah.
Both.
Both. Wow.
Because you're like saying to me, Jeff, do you like the ocean or do you like a lake? I like them both. I'm not going to cut down the lake for the ocean. Chicago pizza, when done right, is magnificent, is joyful. New York pizza, I'm sorry, but that's, you got to go to Italy to get any pizza as good as New York. Yeah. Sorry about any other place. So I love New York pizza, and I love deep dish pizza too. And I would not compare them. And actually, that's my take. They're not comparable. They're two different experiences, two completely different. And I know people who hate deep dish, and I know people who only eat deep dish. Right. They're both wrong. They're wrong because they're both delightful. Lou Malnati's with the cornbread, the corn crust.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Perfection. You know, you go to New York, any place, any corner, the best pizza. Yeah. There you go.
Jeff Garland, thank you for being here, man. You're a superstar and I'm honored to be your friend. And,
Joe, I cannot wait till I give you a hug. Whenever that time is. And you know what I want to do someday? And I told Vivino this, let's figure out a way to gig together.
Yeah.
Something. I want to do something where, and we can even do it for charity, where we combine the blues and comedy.
Yeah.
It's great. I just think that's a natural combo.
Absolutely. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Garland, this has been another exciting episode of Live from Nerville, even though we didn't have a complete intro, but we got one somewhere.
It's all good. Don't you edit this.
I'm not. This is
don't
it.
You,
this
is don't you put in a new intro. Don't make it smooth. Because you know what, Joe? You're not smooth. You're real.
I'll keep it real for this.
You're not a balladeer. What are you doing? Keep it real. All right. Thank you. That was a joy.